Our speaker today will speak on the topic entitled Bringing the DPO into Production and Growth Plans for OceanaGold in Southeast Asia. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and join me give a warm welcome to the Managing Director and CEO of OceanaGold Corporation, Mr. Mick Wilkes.
Thank you, Leo, and thank you for that fantastic introduction. It's a great honour to be here presenting to the Philippines Mining Club. I'd like to welcome Ambassador Bill Tweedy to the Chamber's luncheon today. And it's great to see so many people here supporting the Chamber because, as we all know, a strong mining industry is heavily dependent on the strength of support that it gets from its chamber. And the future of this mining industry in the Philippines is heavily dependent on the strength and the representation that the chamber can make in the political and social arena in the Philippines. I'd just like to welcome Ambassador Delia Albert, who just arrived. Thank you for coming, Ambassador. Leo gave you my background, and I appreciate those kind words, Leo. But I guess I should give you some context about why I am here. I am a mining engineer. I've worked 10 years in Papua New Guinea, jumping out of helicopters, walking up creeks and rivers, doing feasibility studies and landowner agreements over many years. I went to Laos and built the Sepon copper gold mine, which was Laos' first international standard mining operation and now represents over 10% of the GDP of that country. I then went to South Australia in the deserts near Coober Pedy and did a similar thing and focused on Indigenous employment and engagement and set new standards there. I guess what I'm trying to say to you is my passion is social and economic development through mining. That's what I do. And when the opportunity came up for this position, I grabbed it with both hands. Oh, thanks, Eddie.
To the right.
Yep. So the usual cautionary note, which I know you can't read, but I have to put it up there. So the agenda for today is to bring about Didipio. I think everybody in this room would know about Didipio in some way or another. Talk about bringing it into production and the benefits that will flow to the Philippines from that. I'll also talk about our exploration opportunities and our growth plans in Southeast Asia. I'll focus on our culture of sustainability, our community engagement and community partnerships, which are so important to successful mining developments. And also I'd like to share with you my vision for an opportunity for the Philippines. The vision of OceanaGold for 2016 is to be a high-performing, growth-oriented Asia-Pacific gold mining company. We want to excel in exploration and development and operation of gold assets in this region in a safe and sustainable and environmentally responsible manner. This vision is shared by all of my managers and staff. And what we want to do is maximise the returns to our shareholders, because that's how you get reinvestment in the business. We also want to be a reputation as a gold producer of choice, because good people work for good companies. Good businesses work with good companies. Good governments work with good companies. We want to be the gold producer of choice that people say, we're happy to have you in our backyard. We want you to build a project for us. We trust you and we want to share in the benefits of your growth. Enablers for us as a company are basically the fact that we've been operating in New Zealand for 20 years. We're not a company just starting up with an exploration program. We produce 250,000 ounces of gold a year from operating mines in New Zealand. We have an 800-strong workforce, which is rapidly growing, and we're leveraging off these capabilities in New Zealand to grow our business in Southeast Asia. So a quick snapshot of where we operate on the South Island of New Zealand. We've got the Macraes open pit mine and the Fraser's underground mine down in near Dunedin, and the Reefton open pit mine on the west coast north of Christchurch. And also, of course, the Didipio project in Nullagon. We're the largest gold producer in New Zealand, producing around about 250,000 ounces a year. The Didipio project is in construction at the moment, and it's our flagship for future growth. We have a strong management team, proven track record in development and operating gold mines, and a very extensive history of sustainable development in New Zealand. Just quickly on our operations, I mentioned the Macraes open pit. We have about 5.5 million ounces of gold in resources and in New Zealand, and about 2 million ounces of reserves in New Zealand. We have mine life of about 8 years currently and ongoing exploration. We're the largest employer in the South Island of New Zealand. We enjoy very strong support from local government and local communities, and we're part of the fabric of that economy and that society. And I might just add that if you don't know New Zealand as a miner, it's one of the toughest jurisdictions to operate in on environmental standards. So we successfully operate one of our mines within a nature reserve in New Zealand, working closely with the government and the regulators, and very stringent requirements for operating and developing the mine at Reefton, and doing it very successfully. So I just got to say, it can be done, and we have that reputation and experience. So up in Didipio, of course, you all know where it is, in the northern Luzon. It's near the mines of Philex and Lepanto, the very prospective far southeast project at Lepanto. So it's good, historically good mining country. The Didipio project now has a mine life of 16 years, with an annual production of 100,000 ounces of gold and 14,000 tonnes of copper. The reserves, 50 million tonnes. Importantly, Didipio is a high-value deposit. It will produce copper and gold at very low cash costs, which is why, essentially, it's still there. It's worth making the effort to develop this project and reap the benefits for all of the stakeholders. The capital expenditure for Didipio is, as of June 2011, was $185 million. And the total investment to get the project into production is more than $300 million. Now, I know that's not as big as Tampakan, and it's not as big as many projects, but to anyone in this room, that's a lot of money. And it's just an example of how much work, effort and capital is required to bring one project into production. It's also a highly risky business. Everybody who's been in mining knows that it is high risk. And we expect our shareholders to put up that capital to build projects against that risk profile. One way to mitigate against that risk in political terms, of course, is that you need a good mining law, you need good mining policy in the country. It's the subject of a lot of debate here in the Philippines at the moment. And as an investor, you need to make sure that you have secure tenure. And what we have at Didipio is an FTAA, which of course many of you are familiar with, which is a contract between us, OceanaGold, and the government. And that contract is bound by international law. And that gives us the confidence, that gives our board the confidence and our shareholders the confidence that we can go ahead and develop and invest the capital to develop this mine. A little bit of technical detail. It's an open pit mine and an underground mine. The mining open pit operation started in January of this year, just last month. The construction camp and all the infrastructure for the project is nearing completion. We've got concrete going in. We've got steel going up at the moment. We've got over 750 people working on site. And more than 50% of the workforce is from the DPO itself. So, like many of you understand, this is about social licence. This is maximising employment opportunities for our local community. And we have a preferential employment policy which radiates out from the mine, such that the people closest to the operation will benefit the most because they are impacted the most. 35% of our workforce live and reside are billeted to the local community, who are renting their rooms and houses out for some of our people, which is a good measure for me about whether we have our social licence or not. All of the contractors that work for OceanaGold at the DPO are Filipino contractors, and we've only got 20 foreign employees on the site, on the project. The schedule, we are on schedule for the completion of construction and commissioning this year. We are still building the operations village. We've started the mining infrastructure. We've commenced the construction of the tailings storage facility and other infrastructure and the process plant. We're about 30% complete. The biggest risk for us, I'm proud to say, the biggest risk for us right now is weather. I can't do anything about that, but I can do something about everything else. So we're in a really good place. Now, just talking about the financial benefits of the DPO to the Philippines, these are as prescribed under the FTAA, under the contract with the government. There will be $400 to $500 million of taxes and royalties that will go to the state, the province, and the people of the Philippines from the development of this one mine. Our FTAA says that 60% of the net revenues, that's after operating costs and after the recovery of all capital over a five-year period, will go to government and community. 60% of the net revenue, let me repeat, 60% of the net revenue will go to the people of the Philippines. Our excise duty, 2%, that 60% includes 2% excise duty, 30% income tax, some claim owners' royalty and free carried equity, and also the social development management plan, which is about $2 million a year. So there are significant financial benefits to the Philippines. The FTAA structure means that our effective tax rate, so the effective benefit that goes from the contractor to the or developer to the country, is 45%. Now, this is comparable with the highest taxes paid in the mining industry around the world, including the iron ore and coal mines in Australia, which are about the same level. So yes, it's at the high end, but we believe that this is a fair number for our project and our region. The other benefits to the people in the Philippines, obviously employment, 765 people on site, 97% Filipino nationals, 50% from the Didipio region. And our employment targets are dictated by the FTAA, mining and processing professional employed locally wherever possible. 100% skilled and unskilled workers to be Filipino, and 60% of our professional management positions within a couple of years will be Filipino. There's significant indirect benefits and stimulus for the provinces of Nueva Vizcaya, Quirino and Isabela. So we have a preferential employment policy. It's all part of our corporate social responsibility. We have a philosophy of converting resource capital into human capital. That's fundamentally what mining is about. It's what converting what's in the ground to something of value to you and me. It's about making people literate. It's about education. It's about improving living standards. We measure the success of our economies and our peoples by the GDP per capita. And one way to do that is through mining. And everybody has to benefit from it, including the people who put up the money that Sandy was talking about before. These people put up huge sums of money at great risk to allow these developments to go ahead. So they have to benefit from it as well, otherwise the money dries up. I'll talk about the multiplier effect later on when I do my case study. But basically, the IMF estimated some years ago that for every dollar invested in mining around the world, you'll get four times that growth in the economy. So every dollar that's spent in construction, every dollar that's spent in operations on that project, Didipio or Tampakan or wherever else, you get four times that flow-on effect throughout the economy. So that's just in direct money income. Also, you have a 6-to-1 multiplier effect in employment. So when we're in operations at Didipio, we'll have some 500 employees. The direct increase in employment from that project will be some 3,000 people. Just a few holiday snaps of Didipio just to prove to you that it is real. This is the road upgrade, the mill shells coming in from overseas. That was last year, all that work. Some more shots, generators coming in, crushers, concrete works and steel works being put up. That was last year. The TSF construction is started with the screening and aggregate plant there. Some more shots of the concrete works ongoing. That's the flotation plant on the right-hand side. The foundations for that. And in the middle there is a shot showing the start of development. So it's all systems go up there at the Didipio, which I'm very pleased to say. And we're looking forward to its production next year. And then we want to build it for bigger because there's huge potential at the Didipio and its surrounds for discovery and development of more copper gold resources. We plan to increase our throughput to 5 million tonne by 2016, producing 150,000 ounces of gold and 20,000 tonnes of copper, just by the addition of more plant. No new mining plant, no new TSF, no new infrastructure, just a more processing plant. So that will increase the benefit to all of our stakeholders with a minimal capital expenditure. So we're looking forward to developing that over the next couple of years. The exploration potential at the Didipio, like many parts of the Philippines, is huge. And there are two or three other porphyries that we've identified in and around the Didipio area, which is showing strong geochemical soil signatures. We've got our exploration team established, and we've got our head of exploration here sitting, waiting, eager to get the drills running. We plan to spend around $10 million a year on our exploration, which is not an insignificant sum of money. And with that exploration and ongoing commitment to exploration, we certainly expect Didipio to be there operating, producing gold and copper, producing lots of benefits for all of our stakeholders for many decades to come. And then the Philippines, Oceana Gold has 22 tenements in play. Highly prospective areas. The company's been in the Philippines for many years. Some of these tenements have been granted. Some of them are under application. Some of them are held up in the department, as many of you would be aware. And we want to use Didipio as the platform for growth in the Philippines. Oceana Gold is here for the long term, and we want to develop more high-quality, world-class, environmentally responsible mining projects to world's best standards. We also, in doing so, we want to help develop the mining industry in this country. I mentioned before about our culture of sustainability. Now, New Zealand is not an easy jurisdiction to do mining. We've been there 20 years, and we have an excellent track record in environmental management. We actively deliver health, environment, and social community programs to remote communities in the Philippines, but also in New Zealand, where we participate with local community sponsorship and support. Our commitment to sustainable economic growth is firm and strong. And we will continue to build our minds and operate our operations in that way for many years to come. Our community programs in the Philippines include medical missions, where we've had over 30 missions sponsored, bringing medical, dental and optical assistance to these remote communities around Didipio. Over 8,600 people have benefited from these medical missions. Our scholarships over the last 5 years have been numbered 157, awarded to people just from the Didipio Valley, and 41 have graduated with university degrees. Some of those now work for us. Our anti-malarial programs, in partnership with the Global Fund Movement Against Malaria, has reduced malaria by 95% in the Didipio Valley since 2006. We're heavily involved in reforestation programs, a tree nursery program. We've planted over 200,000 trees, over 100 hectares in the last 5 years. We've planted disease-resistant banana plantations to help develop the agricultural industry in our area. We've also provided clean water systems for the people of Didipio, whose water has been contaminated by small-scale mining. Our model for community partnership is one of fourfold. There's the community Didipio Community Development Corporation, which really focuses on developing business opportunities for our people. The Social Development Management Plan, which is dictated by the government and thoroughly embraced by our company. There's an agreement with the local council, the Memorandum of Agreement, about how benefits and commitments are made and shared. And there's the Community Engagement and Grievance Plan and Procedure. The SDMP is mandated under the FTAA as 1.5% of operating costs. Focuses on the usual things that government are involved with: health, education, infrastructure, public safety, livelihood, environment, sport and culture. This valued at about $1.5 to $2 million a year, and we've agreed the split of those funds with the host community, Didipio, with neighbouring barangays, so the barangays or villages that sit around the district, numbering in eight, the municipality of Casabu, the municipality of Carino, and a common fund for shared use. This agreement was signed in January of this year, and everybody is in support of it. The host community, I won't bore you with the details here, but they will receive, if the national government does its bit, 14% of taxes collected by the national government. They have first in preference in employment. They have capital works in the MOA, including the high school, roads, sports centre, and continued university scholarships and teacher support. The neighbouring communities, both upstream and downstream of the mine and along the access roads, combined will receive 45% of these funds every year. That amounts to about 2 million pesos per year for the social development projects, which triples their income, so they don't get a lot at the moment. And they have second preference in employment, and they also benefit from improved infrastructure, etc. The Community Development Corporation consists of the shareholders are the long-term residents of Didipio. It's modelled on similar projects and corporations in Papua New Guinea and in Northern Canada. We've already awarded contracts to that corporation, and over the life of the mine it will constitute many tens of millions of dollars and offering many jobs to the people from that community. So it's all that sustainable development really means: providing an economy and a growing economy well after the mine is shut down. And that's what those business development opportunities are about, and that's certainly our objective. The other important part about developing a project in anywhere in the world, but particularly in places like Didipio, is that you employ people who get it. People who understand the cultural sensitivities, people who understand why they're there, people who are committed to doing a good job and to doing it to the highest standards, and people who can work with others. There are different types of people in the world, And you've always got to make sure that you get the people who get it. So we put a lot of effort into recruiting the right people and making sure they're given the tools and training to carry out their work in a harmonious way. So, enough about OceanaGold, the Philippines. A quick snapshot of the Philippines, we all know it well. Over 80 mineral mines in the Philippines. It's very highly prospective for copper and gold. In fact, I think everyone would tell you that the Philippines is probably the most prospective country for copper in the world. There has, however, been minimal exploration in the last 30 years, which meant that the copper reserves in the Philippines have stagnated. 4.6 billion tonnes of copper reserves, still a big number, but it has stagnated. That figure was 1996. Employment of around 200,000 people, taxes paid $215 million. Mining investments in the six years up to 2010, $3.8 billion. $50 million committed by mining companies to social development management plans over that period, to 700 barangays who benefit from that. So it's not an insignificant industry in the Philippines. We all know that. And we certainly would like it to grow further. The fact is it hasn't grown much in the last 30 years. Let me show you another country, Chile. Chile was one of the poorest countries in South America in the 70s and early 80s. Escondida was discovered in the late 80s, and the government changed their mining policy, which attracted foreign investment from large mining companies into that country. The government's clear policy was to develop their country on the back of a strong mining industry. They now have over 220 mineral mines. The top mineral exports are copper, iron ore, gold and silver. The copper investment over the next 5 years is estimated to be $50 billion. Now compare that to the $4 billion here in the Philippines. They are the largest copper producer in the world. 35% of the world's copper comes out of Chile. This is all in the last 20 years, might add. Mining exports are 47% of the total Chilean exports. And the GDP contribution has risen from 7% to 16%. The GDP contribution has risen to 16% in 2009 and is still rising. They have the highest nominal GDP per capita in Latin America, all because of the mining industry. So clearly, Chile has been a success story through their engagement and embracing a strong, well-regulated, good policy-driven mining industry. The copper reserves in Chile now are 190 billion tonnes. Now compare that to the Philippines, 4.6 billion. And the six-year forward mining investment, as I said before, is $50 billion. Some of the stats are very impressive. And what they are doing is matching the geological potential of the country with good government policy and strong governance. 37% of foreign investment in that country is from mining. Foreign investment is from mining. The mining direct employment increased threefold from 80,000 people to 220,000 people over 15 years. But using the multiplier effect, which we know is real, is 6.5 times more people are employed than the direct number. That translates to over 1 million additional jobs being created in Chile over a 15-year period from mining. That's around 16% increase of the total workforce of the country. And now they're the highest GDP per capita of any South American country. It truly is an impressive result. Now we compare Chile to the Philippines. Population 100 million in the Philippines, Chile 17 million. GDP per capita, GDP almost 400 million in the Philippines, 280 million in Chile. GDP per capita in the Philippines, $4,000. Four times that, it's in Chile, it's four times that. The workforce is 5 times in the Philippines. Unemployment is about the same. Exports, the Philippines is a net importer. Chile is an exporter on the back of the strong mining industry. Ladies and gentlemen, we are in the Asian century. We've got China and India, which are the economic engines of this century. We have iron ore being produced and coal being produced and provided by Australia and Indonesia. And we know that there's vast copper, gold and nickel potential in the Philippines. There is an opportunity for the Philippines to benefit from what is the cauldron of economic growth and prosperity that is Asia. We will be there as Oceania for the long term as part of this opportunity, working with government and community to maximise the benefits to all of our stakeholders. Ladies and gentlemen, Philippines can be the Chile of Asia. Thank you very much.
So the floor is now open to questions. I'll ask the first one. Mick, I know it wasn't easy to get the project started, but could you tell us what in your view was the largest hurdle that Oceana was able to cross in getting this project going? And I guess we kind of want to learn a little more about how that's done, and maybe you can share that discussion with us.
Thanks, Leo. Didipio was discovered in the late 80s, and probably some of you could tell me the month and the date. It went through a number of owners and a number of feasibility studies, and I think the FTAA was issued in 1994, and in 1995 the mining law was passed and then immediately challenged under the Constitution as being unconstitutional. So the project was basically held in abeyance for 10 years until that constitutionality was upheld by the High Court. It was in 2005, after that court decision, that Climax merged with sold the project to Oceana Gold, and the company set about starting construction. In 2007, 2008, I was actually at Prominent Hill, and I know it very well. The GFC had a huge impact on development projects in the mining industry, and costs were going out of control. The project got into trouble, and I'm not afraid to say that there wasn't good management at the time to keep those costs under control, and it was put on care and maintenance in 2008. There were a lot of people that were unhappy with that development, including the people on the ground at Didipio, and they lost their jobs, and some of them went illegal mining them, so some of them were just unhappy that the project was not going ahead. About 18 months ago, just before I arrived, we took a new approach to engage the community to get the project started again. It really is about embracing their needs, wishes, and respecting their rights. And we have forcefully made that commitment to all of my employees and our staff that we will make the community part of our project. Philosophically, I believe that if you have the support of government, if you have a strong mining law, and if you have a strong contract with the government, then the rest of it is up to you as a developer to get your social license. And we've worked very hard to gain that social license from our local community. So, Leo, if I can put it in one sentence, it's all about the local community.
Thank you very much. Gavin?
Do you have any issues at Didipio with illegal small-scale miners? And the second part is, how are you getting on with your local government units?
There are small-scale miners on our FTAA. There were more last year, and they are not causing any inhibiting our construction or operations at this stage. So we have had an ongoing process of compensation for land, and the vast majority of those illegal miners or small-scale miners have now ceased their activities. On the subject of LGUs, we have a very strong relationship with the barangay captain, with a very strong relationship with the municipal mayor and the province, both provinces, Quirino and Nueva Vizcaya. That relationship is also strong. So like the local community, your relationship with your LGUs is also very important. Without them, you can't do it, and we work hard on that.
Thank you for that. Brian, you had a question.
Good afternoon. This is not so much a mining question, more a political question. I'm not a miner, so I can ask political questions, right? But it's really for people like Delia and Leo. I'm not going to ask you to change anything, Delia, don't worry. But quite often in conversations, we keep coming across the issue of the Constitution. It was written by well-intentioned people back in the days before the world started to develop. It was written in a... It was 60, 70 years ago, whatever it was. But, sorry? 1908.
35.
So it's even older than me. Okay. But in the reality is that in the world we now live in and the world the Philippines is competing with Chile and other countries, Indonesia locally and so on, if the Constitution needs to be changed, change the damn thing. Why? We keep hearing that the Constitution doesn't allow this, doesn't allow that. And I know this is an easy thing to say and it's probably a hard thing to do, but it's a long-term, it should be, I think, a long-term objective for those who see the long-term benefits. And some of the numbers that we've just heard from our friend at Oceana indicate that this is the way to go. And if we don't start tackling this problem and removing that major roadblock, this generation or the next generation or the one after that will be suffering the problems of a constitution that's been allowed to live past its sell-by days. Change the small parts that are affecting investment and restricting investment.
Good question. We have among us here, actually in table number 10, somebody who helped draft the constitution in 1971. So I'll ask Joey to comment on the... You belong to the Philippine Constitution Society, right? Would you care to comment on that issue?
First, there are three constitutions of the Philippines, 1935, during the American period. Then this was what was amended by ourselves in 1970. And after that, there was a new constitution of 1987, which is the ruling constitution now. And there have been attempts by previous governments to revise the constitution. Except what causes opposition to it is the revision on the constitution is used to convert our unitary system to a federal system, to convert our presidential system to a parliamentary system. The constitution has been used to extend the terms of the chief executive of the country. And so economic issues become secondary. Whereas if we had the constitutional convention or both houses of Congress meet as a constituent assembly, just on economic issues, just one issue, lifting of the nationalization component on all fields, not only natural resources, this could be done in a couple of months. But we're busy with other things right now. And I won't comment on that. Thank you.
Thank you, Joey. I think you had the right question for the right guy. I think, Ambassador Albert, did you have a question? Did you raise your hand?
Congratulations. I'm glad I made it in time because I heard it was going to be a terrific presentation. I was just wondering, this is not a question, but perhaps a comment. A presentation like that, I think, would do very well in universities, Rotary clubs. I've just come from Zamboanga and I've attended women's conferences, and I went to Kanatuan where we had a terrific visit. I think we are facing a lot of uphill battles because we have not really, the industry has not been communicating to the public that there is a big public out there waiting to hear from the industry. And the presentation today, I think, would be a terrific presentation because it focuses on a very specific project. And I believe that we can surmount a lot of the current challenges if we could spread out a little bit and carry on with perhaps a wider community of people. As they say, well, politics and diplomacy and perhaps mining is about addition. You have to get the message out there. I was just thinking of Rotary clubs, and we have been discussing at the University of Asia Pacific how the Philippines could get into the EITI, Extractive Industry Transparency International, as a stamp of approval of how responsible mining is in the Philippines. And I think the UANP is a terrific venue because they have started discussions on how mining could be a very important, could play a very important role in overall economic development. That's my comment. But a little question. Six years ago, when we first organized the Mineral Development Council, one of the first issues we thought we could solve overnight was an issue in Didipio. And this had to do with a religious individual who had initiated movements to stop the entire project. I was wondering, some of those whom I sent to go and try to talk to everyone who were concerned, and I think at that time you were so scared they wouldn't come back alive, because there was quite a problem up there. But they all came back alive and they said, look, the community is for it, but the religious person who is also the head of the Regional Development Council was strongly against it. So I'm delighted to know that you are moving on in spite of certain roadblocks. Perhaps we can learn from your experience, but from what you've said earlier, a lot of it is community relations. But I was wondering how you made that connection to heaven.
Thank you for that. There's time for at least one more question. I'd have you know that I understand that, Mick, you flew down to Manila, flew up to Manila from where you were precisely to have this conversation with us. So, you know, I think we're all honored that Mick did fly to speak to us today. So, if you have one more question, anybody with a question, then if there's none, then I'd like you to please all join me to thank Mick for flying up to the Philippines just to have this 2 hours with us. Thank you very much. Before you go, as a gesture of our appreciation, you can take this Australian wine back to Australia with you.
You'll have to drink it before I get there.
You can drink it.